So in our last lecture, we were discussing about the basic relationships between the pixels. So we have seen the definitions concerning the connectivities, that is to say the 4 connectivity, the 8 connectivity and the M connectivity. We saw the definition of adjacency, the definition of path, and thereafter we had formulated the distance matrix, and we saw the Euclidean distance metric, the chessboard distance and the city block distance. Now regarding connectivity, just I would like to put forward an example. I mean, actually, as I was telling you in the last class, that the connectivity is definitely defined with respect to the specific set of intensity values. Now as a simple application of it, let us consider that the set V of intensity values, that is composed of just intensity value of 1. Okay, so the set V, let us assume that it contains only 1 element, and that is intensity value equal to 1, and we are considering just a binary image. Binary image means where the pixels can assume values of 0 and 1 only. And let us say that we have a binary image, okay, whose pixel values I am writing in this particular fashion. So let us define a binary image, okay, which I have shown over here, just consisting of element 0 and 1. Now you just see that if I try to see all the pixels having the value of 1, okay, let us mark them. All the pixels having value equal to 1. Now you can see that, as if to say that this is an image, okay, where instead of taking the entire image of an object, we are only taking the image of an outline or the boundary, or which is also called as edge. Okay. Now the image may look like this, something of this nature. Okay, where there will be some intensity value, some high intensity value within this region, and outside the background may be dark. The image is something of this nature, and we are only picking up the edge pixels. Edge pixels means only the boundaries I am having. Now let us define the connectivity with reference to a set V. Okay, and let us say that we are following an 8 connectivity. So 8 connectivity means we will be considering all the pixels, okay, which are there in the 8 neighborhood. Fine. So if we start with any particular pixel, let us say this one, then we will find that there is yet another pixel over here which is 8 connected, and like this we will keep on seeing that which set of pixels having value equal to 1 are connected. And that is very often a very vital information, because many a times, okay, we need to track the the boundary of an object. That is to say, we need to traverse along the age of an object, okay, so that we can extract the information pertaining to the outline. And if we want to track along the boundary or the age of an object, okay, definitely we have to follow the path based on connectivity. And now you can appreciate very well that in the definition of connectivity, the intensity value is very important. In my set, I have defined the intensity value to be composed of just a set of values equal to 1. Okay? This set V contains only one element, that is 1, and my connectivity is now defined in this manner so that I can extract the information pertaining to outline. Remember, I have not included the set as 0, 1. If I had done that, then everything would have been simply connected. Okay. But I am specifically looking for a set of values which are connected together. Now, instead of a binary image, I could have considered an image which consists of, instead of 2 levels, I could have considered an image consisting of 4 levels, 0, 1, 2, and 3. Okay. And in that case, I could have defined my connectivity as a set of values having 1, 2, and 3, eliminating all the zeros. And I would have looked for all the connectivity relationships that the pixels are having intensity values equal to 1, 2, and 3. Okay? So, please always remember, okay, with respect to our last class's discussions, that whenever we are talking of the connectivity must be defined with respect to a set of intensity values. Is that very clear? So, now, with the background of our last class's discussions, okay, we will now proceed further, and our today's topic of discussion is going to be image interpolation and resampling. Now, before we go into the discussion about this subject, let us see that where exactly do we have need to interpolate the image, or where is the need for resampling. Now, many times the images which we extract, okay, from different sensors, okay, they need to be corrected for some kind of distortions which might have taken place in the imaging process itself. Let us take the example of a satellite image, okay, a polar orbiting satellite, let us say, and it is taking the images of the Earth. Now, all the sequence of images which we get, okay, they are to be corrected because the effect of Earth's rotation, okay, that actually creates the image on a distorted raster. So, we have to make appropriate correction with reference to the Earth's rotation, with respect to the Earth's rotation, and thereby we will try to recover the undistorted image. So, that means to say that if our image is originally obtained on a distorted raster, okay, we would like to apply the correction so that the image can be seen on a proper raster or a proper set of grids. Now, apart from this application, many times we need to do some basic geometric transformations on the images. Let us say a rotation. Okay, maybe that the image which we have, okay, is rotated by an angle theta with respect to its original position. Okay, let us say that we are trying to identify an object and we know that it is going to be at some particular position, okay, with some orientation, but in actual image, because of rotation, we find that it has undergone a rotation by an angle theta. So, what we now have to do is that the image which we get should be rotated back by an angle theta in the reverse direction, so that now we can match our expected image with the actual image obtained. Okay. So, in this particular case, what we are really doing is we are applying a geometrical transformation. And whenever we are applying any geometrical transformation, you will find that the original set of samples on which the image was defined, okay, the samples might have been taken on the integer grid values, but after applying the geometric transformation, okay, the transformed set of points will not fall on the integer points, okay. So this is about the rotation, and so that is why if somebody wants the image to be seen in the rotated form on the original grid, on the original integer spacing grid, then of course what he has to do is to take some approximated version of the image, because the points are now defined on some real values, not on the integer grid values. We will illustrate this with an example afterwards. But what we have to do is to interpolate the image, and thereafter we have to take a fresh set of samples on the interpolated image so that we can define the image on the new raster. Okay? So this was about the rotation. Likewise, any object can undergo translation, that is variation in the x and y position. So it can undergo translation. It can undergo rotation, it can also undergo scaling. Scaling means to say just an enlargement or reduction of the image. Okay? And whenever there is a scaling, there also we need to apply some kind of a geometric transformation there. Okay, so we will see each of these aspects one by one. Basically, this geometrical transformation we can very nicely denote mathematically by a relationship of this nature. Let us say that the pixel on the original grid is xy, and after undergoing some geometrical transformation, it is mapped into a new coordinate x prime y prime. Okay, I can define a basic transformation which is called as affine transformation. And this can be defined like this. I define a vector, a column vector x prime y prime, which is equal to a matrix, a 2x2 matrix consisting of elements A, B, C, D. The column vector corresponding to the original pixel coordinate, that is to say the xy. Xy, mind you, is the original pixel coordinate. X prime, y prime is the coordinate after undergoing the geometrical transformation. So this plus yet another column vector whose elements I am calling as alpha and beta. This is the basic affine transformation relationship, and all the operations like rotation, translation and scaling can be defined with respect to this affine transformation relationship. Okay? Now, let us first consider the simpler cases. Let us say the translation. We assume that there is no rotation in the image. There is only a translation. That is to say that I have some object over here and the object has been shifted to some other position. Just an XY translation it has undergone. And can you tell me that what is going to be the structure of this affine transformation relationship if it just undergoes a simple translation? Means I have to define this elements A, B, C, D. Can anybody tell me that how this matrix A, B, C, D will look like if it is just a translation? Excellent. I have got the correct answer. The correct answer is it becomes an identity matrix. So I should have the relationship now like this. X prime y prime is equal to the identity matrix product with XY plus the column vector alpha beta. So what is my translation now? What is the amount of translation now? It is now X prime becomes equal to X plus alpha, Y prime becomes equal to Y plus beta. So that means to say that alpha and beta are my amount of translations. So this was my translation. Now supposing I change the scale of the image, okay, by some factor S, okay. If S is less than unity, I will have a reduction. If S is greater than unity, I will have a magnification, okay. So in that case, in the case of a scaling, what is going to be the relationship? Correct. It becomes X prime Y prime becomes equal to S 0 0 S X Y vector as before plus 0 0 because I am assuming that there is absolutely no translation that has taken place. So alpha beta becomes 0 0 and I simply have from this relation X prime becomes equal to SX, Y prime becomes equal to SY, and if S is less than 1, we get reduction. If S is greater than 1, we get enlargement. Now somebody can say that I will apply different scaling factors for X and Y. Okay? For X direction, I will apply a scaling factor equal to S1, and for Y, I will be applying a scaling factor equal to S2. If I do that, simply this affine transformation matrix will be redefined as this element becomes S1, this element becomes S2, okay, and rest of the things remain as before. So this is the scaling. And if it undergoes rotation, okay, the relationship is very simple, like the way we have the coordinate transformation. Those same relationships will hold good. And for the case of rotation by an angle theta, so I am considering now rotation by an angle theta, and that becomes X prime Y prime is cos theta sine theta minus sine theta cos theta, this product with XY, and if I do not assume any translation, these elements are 0, 0. So this is the rotation by angle theta. Okay. So all these things together, okay, define the affine transformation. Any questions? Any doubts? Pardon? Axis of rotation is the origin. In this relation, okay, it is assumed that the axis of rotation is the rotation is performed with respect to the origin thing. If you rotate with respect to any other point, then accordingly this relation will get changed. Obviously, if instead of rotating with respect to the origin, you rotate with respect to the point x1, y1, very simply, in this column vector, instead of having x, y, you will be having X minus X1, Y minus Y1. Okay?
So in the entire scaling, yes, the number of pixels also are going to be changed.
He was saying that in case of scaling, the number of pixels are going to be changed. Well, it is up to us. I will consider the scaling later on and I will be telling you that how exactly we can do the scaling. We can increase the number of pixels or we can give the number of pixels same as before, okay, or we can reduce the number of pixels. All those things we can do, okay, and if we want to do a scaling, okay, in what manner we should do, okay, that, I mean, those things also we will discuss. So I think I will give a better reply to your question little later. Now let us consider a typical case of rotation, Okay? We take, this is an example. This is example for rotation. We take an image, okay, which is defined like this. This is my axis, okay, x and y axis. This is my x axis. This is my y axis. This is the origin, I'm assuming. And I have an image of this nature. The image of a simple box, okay, a box against a background, okay. So this is the box, and I am assuming that inside this box, okay, it's a binary image. Inside this box, it has got an intensity value equal to 1. Outside this box, it has got intensity value equal to 0. Fine. This is the background. Now, the vertices of this square are, this is 2, 2, this point is 3, 2, this point is 3, 3, and this point is 2, 3. This is how my rectangle is, this is how my square is defined over here. And now, to this image, I give a rotation by an angle theta. Let us say that theta is equal to 30 degree. So I rotate this image by 30 degree. Okay. And my transformation matrix, the affine transformation matrix, now takes the form x prime, y prime, the new coordinates will become equal to cos 30, sin 30, minus sin 30, cos 30, this product with xy. Is that clear? Now, what I will do simply for each of these vertices, okay, I will apply this transformation. For each of these vertices, if I apply this transformation, then what do I get? I will simply get where the vertices will get mapped after undergoing the rotation. So I will find out its coordinates after undergoing the rotation. So let us find it out. So I will take every pixel, like I can take this 2, 2 as the first one. Okay, I take x is equal to 2. Y is equal to 2, I take this particular point, and if I apply this transformation, okay, I am leaving the numerical computations to you, okay, and I will simply give you what result we have got. So for the point 2, 2, I will find that this gets mapped into the point 2.732, 0.732. The vertex 3, 2 gets mapped into 3.598, 0.232. The vertex 3, 3 gets mapped into 4.098, 1.098. The vertex 2, 3 gets mapped into 3.232, 1.598. And my picture will look something like this. After undergoing a 30 degree rotation. Now, Now, what do we find? We find that the original vertices were defined on integer grids. They were values of 2, 2, 3, 2, 3, 3, 2, 3. All were integer values. But now, after undergoing the geometric transformation, I got the vertex coordinates to be 2.732, 0.732, all are now real values. But if somebody is interested in getting the pixel values at the same integer grid points, okay, what is the way out? Like, for example, this is where I have the vertex. I have one vertex over here, and definitely you can clearly see this does not fall in any of the grid intersections. This one does not fall under any grid intersection. None of this. None of these four vertices, according to this numerical values, we find that they are falling on the actual grid points. But what we are interested in is, we would like to know the pixel values at this point, this point, this point, this point, like this, all these points, at all these points, okay, at all the grid intersection points, I am interested in knowing the pixel values. Whereas, nobody has given me those values. So, what do I do now? I have got a set of samples. Only somebody has given me this sample, this sample, this sample, and this sample. And this is, mind you, a discrete image. This image is defined on a discrete set of points, just. I have the value at 2, 2, I have the value at 3, 2, I have the value of 3, 3, I have the value at 2, 3. But nobody had told me that what is going to be the pixel intensity value at the point 2.1, 3.2, something like that, at that point. Nobody had told me. If I had taken the image and if I had considered any particular point over here and asked that what is the intensity value of there, our simple answer will be, we don't know because we have taken the samples at all these integer grid points. So, but we cannot say that there is no pixel value existing there. Because after all, what was the original picture? Original picture was a continuous picture. And we had only taken the samples at the discrete set of points. But now, if I have to give answer to this question that what is going to be the pixel values at these integer grid points after it has undergone the scaling, possibly I could have given a good answer if I had known that what would have been this continuous image function. But right now I don't know the continuous image function because I have already taken the samples. I have digitized the image, so I have taken the discrete set of points and my continuous image is lost. And if I could have recovered or if I had got that continuous image with me, then I could have given a simple answer. If I had known the continuous grayscale values over this entire image, it would have been very simple. I would have looked into that function and said that, okay, I will now sample this continuous image at this set of points and whatever grayscale values, whatever intensity values are there, okay, those will be my intensity values at the defined grid points. Is that clear? So, what is going to be my task? I have to recover the continuous image function. But the task is not simple for me. Because I have taken samples, and the moment I take samples, I have lost some amount of information. Definitely. Now, if I want to reconstruct the continuous function, all that I can do is a kind of approximation to arrive at a continuous function value. So I can only approximate a continuous function, and I can see to it that my approximation is as good as possible. If my approximation of continuous image function is really good, okay, then I can take a fresh set of samples on the grid and I can tell that which values are there. Is that clearly understood? So now what I need to do is a kind of approximation to the continuous values, and this process is called as interpolation. You are already familiar with this interpolation terms, okay, with respect to one dimensional signals. Let us take some one dimensional signal of this nature. Supposing in this axis we have the amplitude of the signal, and on this axis we have time, and I have taken the time domain samples. So whatever I have encircled with red, okay, I am assuring that these are my time samples. Now if somebody tells me that I am interested in finding out the amplitude value at this instant of time, what do I have to do? I have to interpolate this function. And in what manner I can interpolate? Okay, let us say that there is some interpolation technique available with me whereby I can construct a waveform of this nature. Whatever I am showing by a dotted line is a constructed waveform, that is to say after doing interpolation. And after this interpolation, I can take a fresh set of samples, and I can tell you that if I want to know the values at all this time instant, okay, which I have marked by green, okay, I can take a fresh set of samples and define it. This is what one can do in one-dimensional signals. In the case of two-dimensional signal, the problem is not complicated. The problem is just a simple extension of one-dimensional signal. That is to say, instead of taking one axis, you do the interpolation along x-axis as well as along the y-axis. In both axes, if you are doing interpolation, then you can interpolate an image function also. Now, what are the different interpolation functions that are available? Okay, before we go into this, okay, let us summarize the basic purpose of interpolation. If we want to take a fresh set of samples on a different grid, okay, there are two processes which are involved. The first process is interpolation. In our case, it is interpolation of image. And the second task which we have to perform is a resampling after interpolation. Now, why I am calling it as resampling? Because I had taken an original set of samples, and thereafter I had made some geometric transformation. After undergoing the geometric transformation, I have once again tried to reconstruct the continuous image function by interpolation. And after interpolation, I am taking a fresh set of samples. And because it is a fresh set of samples, I am calling this as a resampling. Fine? So, if this is going to be the... So, these two tasks we have to perform. And Can you name some simple one-dimensional interpolation functions? Yes, please. Somebody said sync function. Anybody else wants to suggest some interpolation functions? Now, basically, what should be the property of the interpolating function? Let us again go back to this diagram. I have got a set of samples at these points. Now, supposing I am interested in finding out the amplitude value in between this sample and this sample. What do I need to know? I need to know the values of some previous samples also in order to interpolate. I mean, I have to know, not the previous, rather, I have to know the values of some of the neighborhood samples. If I want to know the value over here, I should know that what value is there with the previous sample, what value is there with the next sample, so that it is easy for me to interpolate. Now, very often, just interpolating with the two neighbors, that is the immediate left and the immediate right neighbor, is not a good solution. We may have to consult the amplitude values of some more samples. So possibly what one can do is, one can take two samples to the left, two samples to the right, and taking these four samples, one can interpolate the function over here. Or somebody can make the interpolation algorithm a little bit complicated. You can say that I will take three samples on the left, I will take three samples on the right, so that I can interpolate the function in a better manner. So, my basic requirement is that while doing the interpolation, we are going to see the amplitude, or in our case, the intensity values of just a finite number of neighboring pixels. Finite number, this finite number is very important because we cannot take an infinite support. That will be, there are two things are involved. Firstly is that it will be computationally intensive. If in order to interpolate the value at this point, I consult all the pixels, okay, which are there in plus minus infinity, okay, there is no point in taking that because a better approximation will be whosoever are closer neighbors, okay, I will take their contributions in order to decide my interpolated value. So, the interpolation must be performed on a finite set of samples. So, rather, I should use a finite support region. So, my basic requirement for interpolation is that it should have a finite support region. And the second requirement is that the interpolation should be smooth. So we should try to do a smooth interpolation without introducing any discontinuities in the function. And the third requirement is that the interpolation which we perform should be shift invariant. Shift invariant means if instead of this diagram, I shift my entire waveform, okay, my interpolating function should not change. So it should be obviously shift invariant. And the function that fulfills all these basic requirements, okay, is a spline function. I think you must have heard of spline functions for interpolation. So we define the spline interpolation function like this. Spline, or it is called as the B-spline function. And the B-spline function is defined like this. So, its definition let the set pi, okay, whose points are defined as xi0, xi1, xin, xin plus 1, which are following this relationship, be a partition of the interval xi0, xi1, okay, on a real axis. So we have a real xi axis, okay, sorry, this is n plus 1. So over the interval xi0 and xin plus 1, okay, I have got a set of samples, xi0, xi1, xi2, etc., etc., up to xin, okay, those many samples I have, okay, on the real axis. So what I am interested to do is, I would like to interpolate the function over the entire real xi axis, correct? And my interpolation function or the B-spline function is defined like this. I am writing it this way. B and xi, the set xi consisting of xi0, xi1, etc., etc., up to xin plus 1. And that is equal to n plus 1 summation k is equal to 0 to n plus 1 xi minus xi k to the power n u being the unit step function, xi minus xi k divided by w xi k, okay, please note it down. I will define the terms individually. This bn, okay, stands for a spline function of order n, okay. This n defines the order of the spline function. N defines the order of the spline function. So a spline function of order n is defined like this. Xi, as you already know, xi are the set of samples. And I have to define this omega. So I am considering the samples. The sample's index is k, and I am summing this expression for k is equal to 0 to n plus 1. Okay? And in this, the definitions are omega xi k is the product over j is equal to 0 to n plus 1 of xi k minus xi j, where j is not equal to k. Okay, and u, I have already said, u is so xi minus xi k to the power 0 means 1. So it is a unit step function. Please take down this expression. So this defines a spline function of order n. Okay. Again, I am showing the earlier page. It shows this is the spline function of order n. Now if I substitute n is equal to 0, n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, etc., etc., I will be getting the spline functions of different orders. Okay. Now I will show you the spline functions of first few orders. So what can be the lowest n? The lowest n could be n is equal to 0. If I take n is equal to 0, in that case, I will be getting spline function of order 0. And let us see that how the spline function of order 0 should look like. If you simplify the expression over here, if you substitute n is equal to 0 in this expression, okay, you will find that what you get is like this. This is our real xi axis, and this was my xi 0, let's say. This is xi 1, this is xi 2, xi 3, xi 4, etc., etc., xi 5, xi 6, xi 7, all these things. And the amplitude of this support region is 1 upon delta, where delta is defined as xi 1 minus xi 0. If xi 1 is defined as, if delta is defined as xi 1 minus xi 0, okay, then this is the kind of curve that I get for n is equal to 0. Now, what type of a function is this? It's a pulse. But what I have to do is that this particular function which I have got, okay, I have to apply this function, or I have to convolve the set of samples with this function. And if I do that, what I get is something like this. Again, I consider it, to simplify my life, I consider a set of one dimensional samples only. So these are my one dimensional samples. So I have got all these samples available with me, and if I convolve with all these individual samples with this function, what do I get? Staircase. Actually, it is not, one should not call that as a staircase, rather the function should look something like this. That is to say, from this sample to this sample, it will go like this. From this sample to this sample, the value will remain steady because it's a window of this nature. The convolving function is a rectangular window. So possibly that's why he was calling this as a staircase. But it will be something like this. You must have heard of sample and hold functions. So this is a simple sample and hold function. Now, as I told you that spline functions, basically spline functions fulfilled by basic requirements. So spline function is also shift invariant. So what we have here is, since spline function is shift invariant, I can take the spline function of 0th order like this. If this is my 0th sample, this is 1, this is 2, this is minus 1, this is minus 2, this is minus 3, this is plus 3, like this. Means I am just shifting the axis. If I do that, then, and I am interested in, this is my xi axis, and I am interested in finding out the value on this real axis. If I want to know that, somebody has given me this set of points, 0, 1, 2, 3, all this are known to me. But if I want it over here, what I will do is, if it is between plus 0.5 and minus 0.5, okay, I will take the function's value to be the sample, this sample value of the, sample value of the zeroth position will give me the intensity value. So as long as I have xi less than 0.5 and greater than minus 0.5, okay, I will consider my f of xi is going to be equal to simply xi 0. This is the xi 0 sample that I have got. So that means to say what? That I am taking the nearest neighbor. Please see over here that if I travel along the xi axis, as long as I am till this point, my nearest neighbor is this zeroth sample. If I travel along this direction, as long as I do not exceed minus 0.5, my nearest sample is this one. So basically what we are taking in this case is a nearest neighbor. And the same thing we can do in the two-dimensional grid also. That is to say in the pixel domain. So what I have is like this. I know the intensity values at all the points which I am marking. I am marking the integer grid points with a cross. And there I know the intensity values. And I am interested in finding the intensity values, okay, somewhere in between. That is, along this entire real space, I would like to know these sample values. I mean, I'd like to know the function values. So what I will do is, if I adopt a nearest neighbor, I will see. If I go over here, okay, till the time I do not cross 0.5, my nearest neighbor is this. Or, okay, let us take some pixel at the middle. Okay. Let us say that from here I move towards minus 0.5. From here I move by a distance of plus 0.5. I move up by a distance of 0.5. I move down by a distance of 0.5. And within this zone, what is my nearest neighbor? This pixel. So, if I want to reconstruct the continuous image function, okay, I will just consult the intensity value of the nearest neighbor and I will replace the continuous, I'll get the continuous intensity function by that nearest neighbor criteria. Of course, that is a very crude way of interpolation because we are only consulting the sign of the nearest neighbor. But as we discussed sometimes back, that one should also consult the intensity values of other pixels. Like if I am interested in finding out the intensity value at this point, okay, there is no reason why I should consult only the intensity value over here. The intensity value at this point should depend upon its other neighbors also over here, right? So we will have splines of higher orders, and that is what I will show in my next lecture. Any questions? Thank you.